I'm going to be flogged by somebody who knows me inside and out, who knows my smells, knows my facial tics, who is going to care about how this works for me, is a very different experience. My first BDSM party. Oh my God, Brittany. Listen. Okay. My head's getting cut off. Hold on. Okay. My first BDSM party. I've told you guys this a billion times, so I'm going to shortcut it. I was with my mentor, who's a woman and a dom, and then she had her friend, who's a woman and a dom. They're both in leather. They're both BBWs. They look the same. They're very, like, badass. And not my mentor, but her friend, very dominating energy. She had a submissive at the time, a boy, a man. And as far as I know, they're still together. But, like, okay. And they invited me into their scene to be in the scene physically without being a part of the scene, which was a big deal. Okay, that's like a really big honor. Yes, okay. So I'm there and I'm watching it, and literally I cannot explain to you what it changed my life. Like, the Brittany I was 10 minutes before this Brittany changed my life. I've never been the same Brittany ever again, right? That was one of those really big moments, you know, when you have a moment in your life and then your path, like, in life deviates or, like, splits into so many options and you're like, oh, I have to pick one. This was a moment for me in the dungeon. So I'm watching these women and they're on either side of him. He's up against the St. Andrew's cross. His arms are up. His back is exposed. And, like, one goes, second person goes, and all of a sudden they are literally having the most perfect fucking synchronization I have ever seen in my life. And his face, so I'm on the other side of where I can watch them hit him, and I'm watching his face. His face goes from thinking about what I have to do for work to looking so fucking stoned out of his mind, even though we're not using drugs, because the adrenaline is pumped through, the energy has moved through his body, and he's having a literal physical amazing experience, but also like an energy spiritual one, a connection to his dom, a connection to my mentor. The floggers themselves are, like, you know, specific kinds of floggers, usually, not always, sometimes, depending on the person. We encourage our bottoms to even touch the toys, to say, like, this is the toy that's gonna hurt you today. I remember when I did one of my first scenes, and it probably wasn't, wow, how does your memory become so bad after experiencing something so important? Well, I had a scene with my former dom, and he was a top at the time and just a sadist. And he had put me up against one of the racks, and he told me to look through my play bag prior to this event. And he said, I'm going to hurt you with everything in this bag, so go through this bag and make sure, did you guys hear the thunder? Sorry. Dramatic over here. He said, look through the bag and double check that everything in this bag you consent to being hit by. I looked through the bag and I didn't think much about anything in the bag. It looked fine. I don't even know if I noticed it at the time either when I was looking through it, but I just, okay. I'm at the dungeon with him and he tells me I'm going to be hurt more than I've ever been hurt before. And I'm like, okay. And he pulled out a butter knife, and I was like, oh, what are you going to hurt? How are you going to hurt me with a butter knife? And he's like, oh, it's just like a big chunk of metal. And I was like, uh-huh. And so he flipped it around to the heavier, like where he was holding it on the lighter side. And he just like, whew, and I just got beat with a butter knife and I cried. And it was great. But it was one of those moments where I was being so bratty, pushing energy towards him that said, you will never make me cry, because that was sort of the goal. And he very calmly was like, okay, sure. And then proceeded to make me cry with a butter knife, because the energy that he was giving me was so confident and indifferent to my bratting. I was so surprised at how I felt in that moment. And I felt, honestly, like, relieved. I think relief is so important in energy exchange, because sometimes you meet those energies that do not give you relief. So as an example, I was thinking about Love the Way You Lie, Rihanna, that Megan Fox, Dominic Monaghan music video. and the Eminem song. And I was thinking about the energy of this couple is the kind of energy I want to avoid for the rest of my life. On the other side, Moulin Rouge is like this romantic movie that I love so much, but I think it is, again, a type of energy and romance I never want in my life. Because both are toxic on different ends. Just as a reminder, in the Rihanna Eminem music video, he kills her and burns down the house. And in Moulin Rouge, she dies of an illness, tuberculosis, I think, and he is an alcoholic. So, we do not want these examples of energy and romance to be, I think, what we aim for. Though no judgment if you do, I guess. Go be you. Yes, Discord, with those gifts for Love the Way You Lie. Like, don't get me wrong. I'm so open to all the different ways people can, like, have their relationships and do their energy exchange. But if you understand, and this is me sounding super woo-woo, so just, like, okay, bear with me. Energy exchange is going to impact you. Stress will impact you. Tension will impact you. Anxiety will impact you. So when you're thinking about who to let into your little energy bubble, just consider that. Because I think a lot of us do not consider energy. We consider the bullet points of their life. Do they have a job? Do they hit their girlfriends? Will they kill me? I think the better question is, does this person bring energy into my life that makes me feel alive and makes me feel optimistic? And vice versa, do I also offer them in exchange optimism and positivity and like a healthy movement forward? Movement, going back to the dance we just talked about, I just want there to be an awareness, and I want to discuss it with you guys, so I'm going to start reading your comments. All of those like layers to me, I don't know if your brains work this way, but they matter to me. It matters to me how our physical energy is, our spiritual energy is, our conversational energy. All of this is exchange, because I think all of it matters, but maybe it doesn't to all people. So if you're one of those people that this does not resonate with, please share. Because again, anything can be bad. I think chemistry with someone could be bad. Guys, what if you have great chemistry with a toxic person? Been there, done that. Been there, done that. And let me tell you, yeah, it's not good. But holy shit, was it fire? Discord says, anger and rage are self-protective. Super useful energy. Humans need to protect what they value. How do we feel? What's the difference between anger, rage, jealousy, and possession? Jealousy and possession, a relationship with you and another thing or person you feel like you own. Rage and anger, a reaction to. Possession and jealousy, a reaction to, or only in relation to a thing. Like, I think rage and anger could probably exist outside possessiveness and jealousy. I'm so hungry. My stomach is growling. I don't want to eat any of that. I don't want to eat. Okay. So, because I don't like the toxicity. I don't like jealousy, but I know it's a real human emotion. That's normal. But because I don't experience it, I have a hard time relating to it or feeling bad about it or having sympathy. But I also know it's like a real fucking phenomenon. Like, it's real. But I'm very possessive. So I'm very much like, I'm possessive. I'm like, that is mine. Tattoo it. It's mine. It's very different though, and I don't feel a lot of anger or rage or insecurity around that possession. So I have a very specific relationship. How do other people's brains work in relation to that? Discord says in reply to the anger and rage are self-protective. Yes, but there's something connected to letting go of things, including pride, which makes it less necessary to use anger. Love versus fear, another person says. I think these are all really important things to meditate on. So I don't know about you guys, but anytime I have these moments in my life, I do try to sit with my thoughts and think like, what do I actually feel? What do I actually think? What do I want? What do I need? And then I try to think outside of myself and just like zoom out and think like, what does this person need? So instead of saying, well, Brittany feels anger, Brittany feels possession. Does this person feel possession? Does this person feel anger? Does this person need me to feel angry? Does this person need me to feel possessive? I want to know how I feel, how I think I feel when I zoom in on myself, how that person feels that I might be interacting with or people. I want to know all of it. You guys know I want to know why. And I think the why matters here. I think it matters so much. But I think there's like this fear of losing people, fear of losing things, fear of letting go, like Discord said, that I think is really crippling. So you're going to want to go and let it go. So sometimes my siblings will be doing something. Let's say we have a sibling who's being really rebellious and they're doing something that's reckless. I'll get a call from another sibling and they'll be like, oh my God, do something. And I'm like, about what? And they're like, call them, tell them not to do this. And I'm like, do they know that we think it's a bad idea? And they're like, yeah. I'm like, okay. Now let it go. Say your piece and let it go so they can live out their life. My mom always struggled with this. My dad was really good at it. It would stress my dad out, but he would often be like, let Brittany go. Let her go. Let her do her things. Let her be reckless. And my mom would say, no, no, no. We have to say something. We have to say something. And my mom would say it 100 times. My dad says things once. He lets me know how he feels and he moves on. My mom, it's like, she can't. She can't let it go. So she has to tell you 1,000 times. But this difference, I think my dad has always been a better mediator. My dad has always had more patience. My dad, even though he's like a traditional masculine man, has always just been able to hear things out before freaking out. And I think that comes from his skill of being able to let things go. Now, I think in my dad and mom's case, they tend to let it go to God. They give it to God. So in a secular kind of bubble like the one I live in, I can't just give it to God. So I just like give it to the universe. I just like give it to the universe. Or I take it and I bundle it up and I put it on my shelf if I need to talk to it later. But if I don't need to interact with that energy, I take it and I throw it into the universe and I say, not my problem. As an older sibling, I struggle, like not wanting, like I want to protect my siblings all the time, but I also know they have to live their life, so they have to make their own mistakes. Anger can arise from hurt a lot of times. Discord, thank you for sharing. I think so too. I think that's so apparent to me that hurt, hurt can come in different forms as well. Is it hurt pain? Hurt rejection, which is not the same. It's pain, but it's emotional versus physical. Am I being punched? Am I being rejected? These are two different feelings and relationships with fear and pain. All of those will make the difference, I think, for how you heal and process and move forward. So I think that's why it's so important to know all of these things. This energy about your intentions. Ooh, I think in order for intentions require self-awareness. Or you can have subconscious intentions. But for the most part, I think you can have the intention of pushing an energy onto someone or interacting with an energy. I think it can show through your energy, but I don't think you need to have intentions to have energy, because I think you are by default energy because you're alive. But I like the way of phrasing it that way, Selena. The idea is energy about your intentions. I just think these things are different, but so overlapped that we confuse them for one another. And I think that's the issue we're all having. I know for me, when I talk out a lot of my ideas, I just end up separating everything into categories. Like, you know how punk comes in all variations? Are you like 1980s punk? Are you 2007 punk? Like, these are not the same, but they're both called punk. You know what I mean? So when you talk about intentions and emotions and energy exchange, energy is default existing. Then you add on top of that your life experience, which shapes your energy, how you are self-aware about your energy, which shapes your energy, how much work you do on your past trauma, which shapes your energy. And then in combination with all those things, your intention and self-awareness about that energy. So I think that all of that matters so much that it needs to be talked about and talked through and talked through and talked through. You know what I'm saying? Ooh, Discord says we love the Yona manga and anime. So note to self. Okay. Openly avoidant says, what you outwardly give to others when interacting with them? ? Good question. Wait, I feel like I'm always moving around looking for the vibe, but I can't find it. Oh, Cassandra, that's really interesting. I feel like I'm always moving around looking for the vibe, but I can't find it. Do you at least have it in yourself? Have you guys ever lived in the present moment? Let's say at a mall, like somewhere crowded, or like a festival, and you're like living in the present moment, you're grounded in your body, you're very present, and you're walking through the crowd, again, much like Korra, dancing through those doors, and you're moving through this crowd, and you can see everyone, you can like, you're almost like, this is going to sound so woo-woo, but you're floating on that cloud of energy that you have within yourself, and then you're navigating where you walk based off the energy like the grass is giving you, because it's living, and in the, when you're living in the present, you're just like so self-aware about these things, or the energy that the people around you are giving you. Like when you're really moving through a crowd, have you ever felt so separate from everybody, but yet like you could dive into any of the bubbles of energy that you're feeling? Is that just me? Have I just done too many drugs? I could feel this even without drugs. But I will say, as I think I move through the levels, like my levels, when I went through my journey, and I still go through my journey of introspection, I feel like when I can move in the present, which is very hard for me. So you guys know I've talked about this. My brain is moving all the time. So I'm always thinking about the future, past, present, mostly the future, and mostly what I'm going to do within the present to make that happen. But when I'm in the present, like the literal, that's why it was so nice having Q visit, because it just allowed me to be in the present so much better. But I was also focused on future Brittany too. So it wasn't a full immersing of the present. But when I'm in a crowd, my favorite thing to do is be in the present and walk through the crowd. It's like being a main character in a music video when you're high. Like imagine you're high and it feels like you're in a music video, is what I meant to say. It feels like that, but like a times a thousand. So when you're doing that, that is all I think. That energy awareness, and then you're moving off of everyone else's energy. I don't know anything about these people. I've never even talked to these people. But yet I bet I could tell you their life story and what they're feeling in the moment. And I bet I could tell you, I bet I could walk up to them and do the right thing in the right moment to make them want me or like me or whatever. Purely with energy, because I know what different energies feel like. But then there's always that opportunity to meet an energy you've never met before, which is something that I think goes back to what you just said, Cassandra. I feel like I'm always moving around looking for the vibe, but I can't find it. Okay, hold on. I gotta switch my... Okay, hold on. Okay, so yes. So what you're doing... hold on. Today, my body really sucks today. Like it's got, what's the word? Just like a weird stiffness in it. My knees are just killing me. They're just fucking killing me. Anyways, what you're doing is you're looking for the vibe. But I think your intuition is blocked. So I think intuition is suffocated and blocked by the noise in the world. And I think that's normal. It's not a big deal. It doesn't matter. The world does not force you to pay attention to it. You force yourself to pay attention to the world. You're just in denial. So if you want a better relationship with your intuition, you have to have a better relationship with yourself away from the world. Ironically enough, intuition will allow you to have a better relationship with the world because it will allow you how to move. It will allow you to move through other people's, like their energy too and their intuition. So then, like the dance that we watched at the beginning of the stream that has intuition involved, an energy exchange involved, you can do that, I think, in the world. I think politicians do it pretty well. Sometimes they're really bad at it, but sometimes they're really good at it. I think that's important. I think dancers, performers, artists, you know, people who have to, comedians, extremely intuitive, extremely aware of energy. Michael says, do you think people can consciously change how their energy is being perceived, manipulate it per se? Yes, I do. I think in order to change how your energy is being perceived, you would have to have the skill set of not only knowing how to change and exude different energy, but you need to have an audience that is open to receiving your energy. Because if they're blocked off, they're not going to be open. I think openness is the key to everything. One of the reasons why my Discord is superior to all of their Discords, one of the reasons why I love it so much is I think we're really, really open. Maybe we're not the most open, but we are extremely open on this Discord. So we're open to all weird ideas. We'll hear people out. As long as you're being genuine and not trolling, and we can tell, it's really cool to be open to energy. So on the Discord, even though it's just our voices, the energy exchange that can happen there is clear. The energy sharing that happens is clear. We can tell when there's tension. We can tell when it gets awkward. We can tell when it's great. We can tell when it feels like this is the greatest social group ever. It's just like hanging out with anyone else. Even with just our voices, we're having those moments. And it's so cool. So I do think, Michael, that you can change how people perceive your energy. But I do think they have to be open. I could be wrong, but I do think so.